इकोलाई एक्सप्रेशन वेक्टर, प्लाज्मिड एक्सप्रेशन वेक्टर। एक्सप्रेशन वेक्टर में भी फॉर यूकैरियोटिक सिस्टम आल्सो, बट वी आर कंसंट्रेटिंग ऑन प्लाज्मिड एक्सप्रेशन वेक्टर व्हिच विल अलाउ एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ योर क्लोन्ड जीन इन इकोलाई। सो व्हाट इज एक्सप्रेशन वेक्टर? So it allows experimenter to control the expression of cloned gene. So if your purpose is to get protein of your gene, then we clone our gene into expression vector, not into cloning vector. PUC vector, PBR322 vectors are cloning vector. So if we wish to get more protein, then we should not clone our gene into PUC vector or PBR322 vector. That is cloning. If you will clone your gene into PUC, so you will get more copy of your gene, your DNA. You will not get high transcription. And if there is no high transcription rate, so you will not get high protein. The purpose of expression, recombinant protein production, it means purpose of cloning the gene in expression vector is to get more amount of protein so that cost will reduce. So scientists have designed expression vector having a strong promoter. As you know, promoter is upstream sequence of a gene where RNA polymerase binds and transcription starts. So in expression vector, you can see this is diagrammatic representation of expression vector. So all components of cloning vector must have in expression vector. In addition to that, expression vector must have a strong promoter. So this is promoter and this is operator. This is Sine-Delgarno sequence. What do you mean by Sine-Delgarno sequence? Sequence where a small ribosomal subunit binds and starts translation. So you can see ribosome binding sequence also, ribosome binding sites also. So this is also present in that expression vector. And this is polylinker, means multiple cloning sites where we can clone our gene. And this is terminator. Terminator of what? Replication terminator or transcription terminator or translation terminator. Generally, this is transcriptional terminator. Sine-Delgarno is name of scientist who discovered that all mRNA have some conserved sequence before a starting codon. And they found that that sequence is useful for binding with a small ribosomal subunit. In prokaryotes, if you remember, a small ribosomal subunit binds with mRNA to start translation, then a larger subunit binds. So this sequence is of mRNA have complementary with a smaller ribosomal RNA of a smaller subunit of ribosome. In this way, a smaller subunit of ribosome attached at this sequence. So suppose you have mRNA of gene X, mRNA of gene Y, mRNA of gene Z, any gene. So gene sequence is different, but their starting sequence before ATG codon, AUG, all mRNA in prokaryotes have some conserved sequence. And they found, scientists found that that conserved sequence is required binding with a small ribosomal subunits. If a small ribosomal subunit will not bind, then translation will not start. So in expression vector, scientists have added that sequence so that when we clone our ORF, we generally clone our gene having ORF, not their upstream or downstream sequence. We only clone generally ORF. ORF means open reading frame. A starting codon to a stop codon containing region we clone. So in that gene there is no Sine-Delgarno sequence. So in vector already they have designed a vector in which they have added that signed Dalgarno sequence. Fine? आया समझ में? हेलो
सर, पूरा क्लियर नहीं हुआ सर, कुछ कुछ पता लगा है बस.
This is sequence of upstream of the mRNA. Upstream, do you know upstream?
mRNA.
No, no, upstream. What upstream. Is upstream of G?
Sir, जो starting में आएगा.
So promoter is in upstream or downstream?
Upstream.
Operator?
Downstream to that.
देख लेना.
Yes, sir.
So operator, promoter, all are in upstream. Region.
Yes, sir.
So from plus one sequence means starting जहाँ से हो रहा है उसको plus one से left वाले को upstream down वाले को हम downstream बोलते हैं. So signed Dalgarno sequence हर mRNA का 5 prime region का part है where ribosomes bind before translation starts.
Yes, sir.
So that that coding region must be present in our expression vector. Then in MCS, we clone our ORF, open reading frame. Then transcriptional terminator, so that transcription should not continue with this ampicillin and other things. If there is no terminator, then it may continue. So this vector must have that terminator sequence so that it will only allow transcription of your gene, cloned gene, not continuously to other genes. So there is terminator sequence also present in this vector. So that transcription will stop.
Yes, sir.
And translational stop codon is also present. That is only triplet codon, so it has been not mentioned here. But stop codons are usually also present in vector. Or sometimes we add in from ORF, open reading frame. Because yes, in open reading frame, there is a stop codon. And these components, yes, ampicillin resistance, origin of replication, these are all common to cloning vector. Selection marker, this origin of replication, this is required. But these components, what is this LACI? LACI is repressor. It will code repressor protein so that it will bind at operator and transcription will remain silent. Fine?
Yes, sir.
So this is components of expression vector. Now we will see this. So expression vector must have a strong promoter. A strong promoter means the gene cloned under this promoter will express rapidly, will transcribe rapidly. Rate of transcription will be more. Some promoters are weak promoters. Some promoters are strong promoters. A strong promoter means the gene cloned under it or gene present under it will transcribe rapidly. Per unit time, rate of transcription is more. So through research, scientists have found that there are so many natural strong promoters present in nature, in other cells. So they isolated that promoter and during designing of this expression vector, they have added that as strong promoter. So there are several known strong promoters which scientists use to add in the expression vector or during designing that expression vectors, company or scientist add. So these are some strong promoters which are present in expression vector. E7 promoter, LAC promoter, TRP promoter, TAC promoter, TRC. So this TAC and TRC is hybrid promoter, not naturally present in upstream of any of the gene. This is hybrid. So scientists come to know through research that what are the sequence required to become that promoter a strong or weak. So for a strongness and weakness, there is some sequence. There is some consensus sequence. There is distance between the open reading frame and the operator region or first, that minus 10 sequence. So through research, they found that what are the sequences present in a strong promoter. In this way, they designed the promoter. So this TAC promoter and TRC promoter is a strong promoter, and but this is hybrid promoter. This is not naturally present in any gene. But this TRP, tryptophan promoter, LAC promoter, you know lacopran, T7 promoter, this is viral promoter. T7 virus have this promoter. So these all lambda PL, these all are strong promoter. This, if you clone your gene under this promoter, so this promoter will allow rapid expression of your gene. This transcription will be high. If transcription is high, so obviously if mRNA is present against your gene, so it will participate in translation. So ultimately you will get more amount of your protein. That is ultimate purpose of expression, so that rate of production will reduce. So we need to produce more amount of protein, recombinant protein. For that, scientists have designed this expression vector. So they added a strong promoter. Second thing, in expression vector, promoter should be strong. Second thing, promoter should be inducible. अब ऐसा नहीं कि बहुत ताकतवर लोग बना दिए घर में, बच्चे को खिला पिला कर आओ, फिर पेरेंट्स को ही पिटाई करने लगे. सो प्रमोटर मस्ट बी स्ट्रांग, बट व्हेन वी विश देन ओनली इट शुड स्टार्ट ट्रांसक्रिप्शन, अदरवाइज इट रिमेन साइलेंट. आर यू गेटिंग? इंड्यूसिबल प्रमोटर मीन्स when we add inducer, when we wish that this transcription should act now, it should start transcription, then only it should start transcription, otherwise remain silent. So in expression vector, our promoter should be strong and it should be inducible. Inducible means when we wish, then we add inducer, then it should start, otherwise it will remain silent. So two things are very important. So what do you mean by, see, a strong promoter means here is gene, here is a strong promoter. So gene cloned under this, or gene present under this strong promoter. So you can see there are several mRNA. So if there are several mRNA, so it will produce several proteins. So rate of production of protein will reduce. That is our scientist, our purpose. Here weak promoter, so rate of transcription is less, so production of protein is also less. That's why we use strong promoter. Inducible promoter means when we add inducer, then it should start transcription. Otherwise, it remain silent. When we don't add this inducer, it should not express. That is inducible promoter. Fine. In expression vector, promoter must be strong but inducible. Promoter may be constitutive. There are two types of promoter. One is inducible, one is constitutive. So in natural conditions, some promoters are expressing their gene continuously whole life. Like which type of gene need constitutive promoter and which type of gene requires, in I'm talking about natural condition, not about this vector. Which type of gene should be present under inducible promoter and which type of gene should be present in natural condition, which type of gene should be present under constitutive promoter? Yes.
So the functions which the cell has to regularly perform should be constitutable and other should be inducible.
Yes. That is housekeeping gene. वैसा जीन जिसका प्रोडक्ट हमको हमेशा ही चाहिए, that is housekeeping gene. Metabolic activity के लिए. And some genes products are not required always. Suppose when heating, when we are going in cold environment, then we need some proteins which can protect our body from cold. then that gene which will help to protect from cold, that gene will start producing that protein. Like in bacteria, when lactose is added and there is no glucose, then only lactose, lactoferrin start transcription. So that is inducible promoter, you can say. When we add something, then it starts expression. Fine? So these are so many examples of that promoter, strong promoters. I'm not going to discuss this in detail, what are the sequences. So we have already discussed this. And in most of the expression vector, we must have that affinity tag coding sequence. Affinity tag coding sequence is also present in this vector. Now question is, suppose we are producing insulin in E. coli. We have cloned our insulin gene in this vector and transfer it into E. coli. Now E. coli will produce that, suppose. So how can we purify? How can we purify that insulin protein? Because there are thousands of protein, E. coli protein is present in that cytosol. So how can we purify that insulin? Suppose we clone our gene and express it into E. coli. So this is not sufficient, that E. coli have several proteins, means your proteins, insulin protein is present in E. coli. Now how can you purify it? You cannot use their complete E. coli extract. You have to purify it now, insulin protein from E. coli. Because E. coli have several thousands of protein, their own protein in cytosol. From that thousands of protein, you have to purify your desired protein.
Yes.
How can we purify? Yes. So, for purification purpose, we add some affinity tag coding sequence. We add a sequence, DNA sequence, which code a protein which is used, which can be used for purification. And that tag is known as affinity tag. So, here, before MCS, there is affinity coding tags. Means affinity tag coding genes should be present in this vector before MCS. So that when you will produce your protein, that tag will be conjugated with your protein so that you can easily purify your protein from E. coli cytosol. Are you getting? There are affinity means what? Affinity, two things. Generally, in this case, we use polyhistidine tag, we use maltose binding protein, we use GST glutathione S-transferase protein. So this is also polypeptide. But we know that how this polypeptide will attach with our column. We have that affinity column. Suppose our protein is tagged with nickel, this polyhistidine, then we know that how polyhistidine will attach with our column. So there is nickel and TA column in which there is bead, packed bead having nickel and TA. So when we cross break that E. coli and you can say centrifuge it so that all debris will be settled down, and in supernatant there are thousands of protein including your protein. Since your protein have that affinity polyhistidine at its N terminal or C terminal, so when you add all thousands of protein solution in the column, nickel and TA column, so your protein will remain attached with that column. Other protein will be washed out. It will be comes down from that column because there is no affinity tag with that other proteins. Are you getting? In this way, for different affinity tag, there are different columns, matrix available. For polyhistidine, we will discuss later on, but for polyhistidine, we use nickel and TA column. because we know that through research, we know that this polyhistidine have high affinity, a strong affinity with nickel and tin. So our protein, which is conjugated with this polyhistidine, will remain attached with that column. And that column is filled with the bead matrix having nickel and tin. Other protein, thousands of other protein will be washed out. Then, since now your column have only your protein attached with that bead, then you have to elute. You add some reagent because you know that what is the attached thing. So you add some competitor so that your protein will be elute out and that competitor component will remain attached with that column. In this way, we do affinity purification. Affinity means attachment ke liye. So bahut sare component ka attachment ka partner known hai. Accordingly, we add that sequence so that our protein will be conjugated with that affinity tag. And that affinity tag will attach with this matrix when we isolate protein, when we isolate total protein from E. coli extract. Fine?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So this is actual vector map. We use this vector frequently for recombinant protein production. This is expression vector. This is a schematic diagram only. This is actual vector which we can purchase from companies. Some company provide this vector, generally PET vector. So what are the specialty of this vector? So you can see it has T7 promoter. It has histidine tag coding sequence. It has T7 tag coding sequence. This is multiple cloning sites. Here is multiple cloning. You can see my arrow. This is multiple cloning sequence. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So there are 11 restriction sites clustered at one place. So you can use these sites, any of these sites, for cloning of your gene. You digest this and digest your desired gene and you can clone. So this is frequently used vector PET28A. Because
so
this
you're
vector-
talking about this dark arrow, this black arrow. So ye jo dark sa arrow hai, aap iski baat bata rahe hai na, jo MCS hai. ये बहुत डार्क करके एक एरो बना हुआ है
नहीं 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 हाँ ये डार्क एरो है लेकिन ये
यही MCS है ना सर
इसमें और दूसरे कंपोनेंट्स भी हैं ये MCS का मतलब रेस्ट्रिक्शन साइट सो यू कैन सी दिस
यस सर
सो दिस इज रेस्ट्रिक्शन साइट्स
यस
दे कैन नॉट शो हियर सो दे एक्सटेंडेड इट सो दीज आर रेस्ट्रिक्शन साइट्स
यस सर
Since these are clustered at one place, ये सब भी restriction site है ना पूरा, but we cannot call it MCS.
Yes, sir.
Here, suppose this is NCO. So NCO is not present anywhere in this vector. This is only here. ND not present in anywhere in this vector. So these all are unique sequence, singly present in this vector. Here only. And since there are several restriction enzymes clustered at one place, we call it MCS. Because we should use only these sites. Because we have designed a vector in such a way that if we will clone here and there, then we will not get desired product. Our purpose will not solve. We will not get transcription, proper transcription and translation. So we will not get protein. So this vector have T7 promoter, kanamycin resistance gene. So if you transfer this vector into E. coli, so don't add ampicillin. Then you cannot select, you have to add kanamycin. So different vector depending now is during MSc when we ask a student in which antibiotics you have grown your culture from which you are going to isolate plasmid. So they don't know. So based on the vector, based on the plasmid which you are going to isolate, you must see that whether that culture is we are growing in that respective antibiotic containing media or not. Suppose you are isolating PUC, तो वो कल्चर किस एंटीबायोटिक में ग्रोन होना चाहिए? Suppose in laboratories during MSc, someone has given you culture so that you can isolate PUC vector. They said your technical staff said you that isolate that PUC vector, but you are not getting that. So which antibiotic you should think that this culture should be grown in that antibiotic containing media, LB media? Are you getting my point? So in PUC there is no kanamycin resistance. That's why I asked you. You must see that whether your technical staff have grown your culture in ampicillin or not. Then only you will isolate that PUC. If you are isolating this PET vector, so whether that they have grown this culture in which there is PET vector in kanamycin or not. So depending upon the vector, when you are isolating that plasmid, this is normal protocol to isolate plasmid during BSc and MSc. But generally, when we ask in interview, in which media you have grown, which antibiotic containing media you have grown it, you must understand which type of antibiotics you should add and grow that bacteria. So it's depending upon the vector. Kisi vector mein ampicillin resistance hai, kisi mein kanamycin, kisi mein tetracycline. Depending upon that, you should add that antibiotic. Fine.
I'm going to press.
Hello. Someone is asking something. Hello. This is another type of expression vector. This is also expression vector, but you can see in this expression vector tag is maltose binding protein. In PET vector, affinity tag is polyhistidine, means 6 histidine coding genes are present, so that it will conjugate 6 histidine amino acid in your protein. Here this is maltose binding protein. So if you will clone your gene in this vector, your protein will be conjugated with this maltose binding protein, and this vector have TAC promoter, TAC promoter, and again in this vector MCS in lac z alpha gene, so that you can do blue white screening. So main characteristic feature of this vector is maltose binding protein, have affinity tag is maltose binding protein and TAC promoter. And there are several variants of these vectors are available and scientists are using it. So suppose you have to produce your protein in E. coli, and that protein requires disulfide bond formation. Fine. So can E. coli cytoplasm allow disulfide bond formation in your protein? You can write in message. E. coli cytoplasm allow disulfide bond formation in your protein or not? Why not, Ramesh Kolhe sir? So, oxidizing environment is required.
Yes, sir.
But in E. coli cytoplasm, there is a reducing environment. So, it will not allow disulfide bond formation. Fine? Hannah?
Yes, sir.
disulfide bond means sulfur sulfur bond will form. How? By removing H. SH से H remove होकर के SS बनाएंगे. तो removal of hydrogen is oxidation. So disulfide bond formation is oxidation. But E. coli cytoplasm will not allow oxidation because their environment is reducing. Then we will not get disulfide bond formed protein. Fine?
Yes, sir.
So there are several ways to solve these things, but one way is to transfer your protein after protein synthesis translation. Transport your protein into periplasm of E. coli. Periplasm can allow disulfide bond formation because periplasm of E. coli has no reducing environment. Fine? What do you mean by periplasm of E. coli? The periplasm is the space between the inner membrane and the cell wall. There is a space. So that space allows disulfide bond formation. So if your protein will get transported in that space, so your protein, if your protein have that cysteine, 2-cysteine, then it will form disulfide bond. So we have to, sometimes we have to transport our protein into periplasm. What are the other advantage of producing our protein into periplasm? Are you getting? One advantage is to get disulfide bond formed our protein. What are the other advantages? Suppose our protein doesn't require disulfide bond formation. Then, so periplasmic, suppose periplasmic expression is good or cytoplasmic. Mind it, that expression means synthesis will take place in cytoplasm only, not in periplasm. But sometimes we wish to transport our protein into periplasm. So periplasmic transportation is better or not? Or how it is beneficial? Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Batao.
Sir, because the, like you told that E. coli doesn't allow this oxidation reaction to happen. So if we transport it outside, we can perform such reactions, which are mandatory to be performed over there.
In addition to this disulfide, what are the other oxidations? Forget about this oxidation mechanism. Other advantage I'm talking about. Otherwise, you will deviate. So, purification of your protein will be easier from cytoplasm or periplasm?
Periplasm.
Why? Yes, Simant Kumar, you are right. Purification will be easier from periplasm. But why? Why not from cytoplasm? So, since periplasm have less types of protein, less amount of other E. coli protein, so there is less chances of contamination or mixing with other protein. Grooms dhoondhna hai 50 logo mein, grooms dhoondhna hai pura cast mein. So difficult ho jayega aur 5 hi log mein dhoondhna hai, it's easy. 5000 logo mein dhoondhna hai, it's difficult. So periplasm have very less proteins. So purification of your protein become easier. Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Second advantage. Or disadvantage. Sure, advantage. Disadvantage. So both I have discussed advantage. Then why we produce in cytoplasm? So this advantage of transporting our protein into periplasm
is plasmid size will increase. Plasmid size will increase.
Plasmid size.
Because we will add some extra gene, some extra part gene that will make it to transport it to periplasm.
Okay. That one step extra. Advance. I'm talking about disadvantage. So disadvantage is there are limited space in periplasm. So you cannot accumulate more amount of your protein in periplasm. Cytoplasm have comparatively more space. So your protein production will be more. It can accumulate more protein. Are you getting? So yield, overall yield will be lesser. If you will transport your protein or your protein will transport into periplasm, then periplasmic space are very less. So yield per unit liter or per unit culture, whatever you can consider, is less than cytoplasmic production because cytoplasm have more space. So that is disadvantage. But depending upon our purpose, there are two types of vector. The vector which allows transport of your protein into periplasm, and the vector which will not allow transport of your protein into periplasm, means it will remain in cytoplasm. How can we design a vector so that our protein should go in the periplasm? What should be the extra part present in that vector so that our protein will be transported into periplasm? After translation in cytoplasm, it should go in periplasm.
What so should koi bhi aisa protein jo periplasm mein ho ya koi bhi aisa gene jo wahan pe present ho, अगर हम कोई ऐसा जीन ऐड कर देते हैं जिसकी उसके साथ एफिनिटी है या उसके एक्सप्रेस प्रोटीन की उसके साथ एफिनिटी है तो वो अपने आप ही बाहर जाके बाइंड करेगा.
तो जनरली इकोलाई का अपना प्रोटीन कैसे ट्रांसपोर्ट होता है, इफ वी नो दैट मैकेनिज्म हाउ सम ऑफ द प्रोटीन्स ऑफ इकोलाई इज प्रेजेंट इन पेरिप्लाज्म आल्सो बट सिंथेसिस टेक्स प्लेस इन साइटोप्लाज्म. सो हाउ E. coli send their own protein into periplasm. If we know that mechanism, we can utilize that knowledge for creation of our vector. So generally, there is signal peptide. Signal peptide leads the protein towards their respective compartment, respective organelle. So different signal, you have some I card of your college, then only you can enter in your college or university. I have my I card. Can we use my I card for your college? So that is signal peptide, which is present in usually in end terminal of the proteins. So scientists through research come to know that what are the signal coding sequence, signal peptide coding sequence they have added in the vector. And then, so if you will take my I card, and so you can enter in other my institutions, provided that security guard should not take your photo. So scientists come to know that there are so many signal peptides, known signal peptide, which lead to transportation of the protein from cytoplasm to periplasm. So they take that signal peptide coding sequences and design our vector. That vector is should be used to transport our recombinant protein from cytoplasm to periplasm. So based on that periplasmic expression or cytoplasmic expression, there are two types of expression means translation will take place in cytoplasm, but it should be transported into periplasm. So based on that, there are two types of vector, here you can see female C4X, female P4X. P here stands for periplasm. P stands for cytoplasm. So everything is same in female C4 and female P4, except what? So female P4 have extra signal coding sequence. So that along with affinity tag, our protein will be conjugated with that signal peptide also. So if there is signal peptide, our protein will be transported into periplasm. So based on that, there are two classes of vector: periplasmic expression vector and cytoplasmic expression vector. Even in case of pit vector, there is also periplasmic and cytoplasmic. Here you can see there are different variants of PMAL vector. All PMAL variants have MBP tag, maltose binding protein tag, tag promoter. Along with that, some have cytoplasmic expression system, some have cytoplasmic periplasmic expression system. So in periplasmic expression, everything is same except that signal peptide coding sequence, which is present in periplasmic expression. Fine. Now question is again, can we use that tag if suppose we have produced our recombinant protein which is tagged with MBP and size of this MBP is 44 kilodalton. This affinity tag, size of this affinity tag is 44 kilodalton. So for therapeutic use of protein, that Federal Drug Association or some here drug controller will not allow extra protein. Suppose you are using your recombinant insulin as a therapeutic. So your insulin is tagged with this MBP. So this MBP will hamper its activity inside the human. So scientist or the drug controller agency will not allow extra peptide. So what we should do? Find that all these affinity tags are conjugated with your protein by that same polypeptide bond, because this is also amino acid sequence. This affinity tags are amino acid. This is also polypeptide. It will remain attached with your protein. So what we should do? So after purification, our affinity tags should be removed. Are you getting? Function of affinity tag is to purify your protein from the mixtures of thousands of protein present in E. coli. Because you have produced your recombinant protein in E. coli, so your protein should be purified from other protein. It should not be contaminated with other protein. That's why we use affinity tag. There are three basic methods of protein purification: either affinity purification or size exclusion or ion exchange. So affinity purification method is best method. So scientists have designed this affinity purification method for this recombinant protein, but this affinity tag is not desirable if that protein have that therapeutic purpose. If we use that protein, recombinant protein, as a therapy, as a drug, then that tag should not be attached. It should not remain attached. So how can we remove it? So during vector designing, scientists have added this sequence which will code a protease cleavage sequence. So that after purification, affinity tag should be removed. So based on that, this you can see, this is variants of PMAL. So PMAL means plasmid, MAL means maltose binding, C stands for cytoplasmic expression, and this is generation. During my PhD, I have used C2X. Now there is C4. they add some sequence or delete some sequence. In this way, they change that generation. Now it is PML C6 people are using. So C stands for cytoplasm, and X, what is X? So this X stands for factor XA cleavage sites. So between the affinity coding sites and your protein, there is sequence which code for an amino acid polypeptide, where that is a protease sites. As you know, like restriction endonuclease recognition sites, some protease have a specific recognition sequence. So there are different reagents which have different specificity of amino acid where it will cleave. So if we design a vector in such a way that there is amino acid sequence which bifurcate affinity tag as well as your protein. So after purification, after binding with that affinity column, other non-desired protein has been washed out. Our only protein will remain attached with that column, affinity column. So we add that reagent, and that reagent will cleave that proteins between affinity tag and your proteins, so that you will get only your protein, not any extra polypeptides. So depending upon which protease has been added, protease cleavage sequence has been added in the vector, the different variations of vector. Companies supply different variations of vector. So if that protease cleavage site is with factor XA, then we call it PML C4X. If it is intrakinase cleavage sites, then we call it PML C4E. If this protease is genase 1 cleavage site, we call PML C4G. In this way, based on the cleavage site present between the affinity tag polypeptide and your protein, scientists have, our company have named these different vectors, PML vectors. Anybody have used this PML vector? So these are different categories of PML vector. PML vector is one type of expression vector. PET vector have different, this is also expression vector, but in PET you will get polyhistidine tag. Here you will get maltose binding tag. In PET vector, there is T7 promoter, here there is tag promoter. You can see, you were asking about how to purify. So if you clone your gene in PET vector, so your protein will be conjugated with polyhistidine. So this polyhistidine tagged protein can be purified by nickel and TA column. Nitrito acid something. This is nickel, this is a, you can say metal, and this is some organic acid which is bound with that sifferose column. So we use this column for purification of this protein. And purification means it will remain, it will be attached with this nickel and TA. And other protein which are present in that solution mixture will be washed out. So this is now attached. So how can we elute? How can we detach our this protein from this column? Then it is useful. So for detaching, we call it elution. When attached protein we detach, that is called elution. So how can we elute? By adding imidazole. Here, if you clone your gene in this vector, PML vector, you will get your protein conjugated with MBP, maltose binding protein. For purification of that maltose bounded protein, we use amylose column. And for elution, we use maltose. This is competitor of this MBP. This is competitor of this polyhistidine. Tjax, this is also expression vector, which have 26 kilodalton GST tag, glutathione S transferase. For this we use GST column and for elution we use reduced glutathione. After synthesis of protein, we break the cell, E. coli cell, centrifuge it so that all broken part debris part will settle down as a pellet. And in supernatant, there are thousands of protein along with your protein. So you take that supernatant and add in the column, affinity purification column. In that column, your protein which is conjugated with that affinity tag will remain attached. You wash that column so that non-specifically bound protein will be washed out. Then you add that protease so that that affinity tag will remain attached in the column and your protein will be eluted in the centrifuge tube or any tube which is below that column. Are you getting? You can see that affinity purification. So this is glutathione agarose bead, which is packed in this column. No, elution means Simant Kumar. Elution means here you can see elution with glutathione means when we add thousands of protein in this column, so all proteins which doesn't have this glutathione tag, affinity tag, will be coming out. It will be eluted out. It will be washed out. So to remove all non-specifically bound, maybe some protein have some non-specific attachment. So we add some buffer so that all non-specifically bound protein will be washed out. Then we add eluting reagent so that attached our protein should be eluted in this. Now you have this purified protein. During that time, if you wish to detach, remove that tag, so add that reagent here. Then you don't have to elute. Add that protease in this solution here, so that affinity tag remain here and your protein will be here. Fine? Affinity tag plays role in purification, not in elution. So we have discussed two types of vector, expression vector for E. coli, not for other bacteria or other eukaryotes. I have discussed only plasmid expression vector used for E. coli host. We will again discuss in last day when we will discuss that expression strategy of cloned gene. Then we will discuss few more expression plasmid. But there also we will discuss only E. coli expression plasmid. Fine? So now I'm talking about other vector. We all know about this bacteriophage vector. So we will not go in detail all these vector, but yes, if you have any queries, question, so quickly I'm going through that vector. So we use bacteriophage vector because this vector have more carrying capacity. In PUC or PET or this cloning vectors, plasmid cloning vector, it cannot carry more than 5-6 kb gene. Plasmid vector have limitations. You cannot clone 20 kb or 10 kb gene. Then it's difficult to replicate or to propagate. So scientists have searched other vector so that they can use it for cloning of longer DNA. So they found that virus is also sending their genome into the E. coli, where it replicates and duplicates. So why not we add our desired DNA in the genome of this bacteriophage, so that if this bacteriophage sends its own genome, then our desired DNA will also go inside the E. coli host, and it will replicate, duplicate, multiply. So scientists using that bacteriophage as a vector. I will not discuss the lytic and lysogenic phage. This is microbiology thing, but you should know during DSC how it is amplifying. So what are the features of bacteriophage vector? So bacteriophages are natural vectors that transduce bacterial DNA from one cell to another. So this bacteriophage send their genome into bacteria. That is known as transduction. That's why they have written transduce. Virus which infect E. coli having head and tail region. This is lambda phage. This is the structure of lambda phage having head and this is tail region. You all know this. And its genome size is 48.5 kb. The bacteriophage genome is linear, it's not circular, and size of its genome, total genetic content, you can say that genome is 48 kilobase, which is packaged in the head. Life cycle has two phases, either DNA integrates into the bacterial chromosome or prophage, this as a prophage, are produced complete phage particle which release after lysis of bacteria. So their genomic DNA go inside the cell where it will amplify and again it will produce new phage particles. So hundreds of phage particle will be produced from the one single cell. In this way it amplify, bacteriophage amplifies. Bacteriophage cannot amplify outside cell. Outside E. coli cell. So phage vector infects cells much more efficient than plasma. This is main feature you can see. So if we transform E. coli cell with plasmid, so transformation efficiency is not as much as the infection efficiency with phage vector. So if we have to transfer several genes in case of library formation, then we should use bacteriophage, because if we clone our gene and we have millions of types of that vector, millions of vector copy and having millions of fragments of your genomic DNA, then we expect or we desire to transfer all that recombinant plasmid into different E. coli host. So if transformation efficiency is less, so some of the clone remain untransformed. So you will not get representation of complete genomic DNA in that library. So transformation, or you can say introduction or injection efficiency of bacteriophage is more than plasmid transformation. The head of bacteriophage can accommodate certain range of DNA. Its head can extend bigger, it can enlarge, or it can shrink. Don't think that only 48, if we will change 48 to 49 kb of its genome, it will not accommodate. It can accommodate. It can accommodate up to 55 kb DNA, provided that have some characteristic which can be recognized by that head protein. It can accommodate certain amount of longer genomic DNA or certain amount of smaller genomic DNA. So that is beneficial for us. So you can see that accommodation range is 38 to 52 kb. So two small DNA cause formation of non-infective particles. But if you will try to pack this viral protein, viral cap with 20 kb of DNA, then that virus will not work. It will not be functional. It will not be infective. If their genomic size is in this range, then it will be infective. And terminal 12 bases are also a characteristic feature of its genome. It should be a terminal of that genome, then only your DNA will be packaged. So there are two types of bacteriophage vector scientists are using. One is called insertional vector and other is replacement vector. In insertional vector, there is no removal of any sequence from phage genome. Phage can accommodate about 5% more or 10% more than normal complement of DNA. So if we wish to add in our gene in their genome, so its size will increase. So you cannot add longer DNA because there is limitations of accommodation in. So it will only accommodate 5 to 10% extra. Since you can consider if 5 to 10% extra it is accommodating, so 5% of 50 is 2.5. or 10% is 5 kb. So in insertional vector, we cannot clone more than 5 kb, 6 kb DNA because we are not removing any part of its genome. Just we are cutting their genome and ligating our desired DNA. This type of vector is called insertional vector. Means we don't remove any part of their genome, but we cut at appropriate place in genome. And then we add our desired gene and ligate it and then package it into its cap protein and then we allow to infect bacterial culture. So this insertional vector have this trade name. Company which designed this vector having due to some restriction sites, some to beta galactosidase enzyme, they have different names. So lambda GT10, lambda GT11 and they are different vectors. This is trade name of this insertional bacteriophage vector. Second type is replacement vector, in which, as you know, in insertional vector, there is very limited space. We can only clone a small size of DNA. So scientists through research found that some of the region of its genome is not very useful for its survival. Bacteriophage survival and its infectivity. So they remove their non-essential part. Now it's become a smaller. So now accommodation capacity, suppose aapke ghar mein 5 log hai aur 5 hi bed hai, ek log ko hata dijiye, to aapka jagah bach gaya. Ya 5 log tha to 6 bed hai to ek log accommodate kar sakte the maximum. So we replace 2 people from our family so that we can accommodate more people. In this way, scientists remove that non-essential parts of their genome so that they can accommodate their own DNA, larger DNA, their own larger fragments of DNA. That is replacement vector. And the removed part from the genome, removed non-essential part of the bacteriophage genome is called a stuffer region. So in this way, replacement vector have more capacity, more carrying capacity. And the name of that replacement vector is charon. And there are series of charons. First phase vector were constructed by Fred Gartner and colleagues. Removed middle region, retained genes needed for phage replication. So middle region which has been removed should not have any essential gene. Otherwise, this phage, when it will send their genome into the bacteria, it may not replicate, it may not duplicate. Then it will not serve our purpose. So, through a study, they found that some of the parts are non-essential and they removed that part only. They did not remove any essential gene. So, originally named charon phase, okay, fine. What are the advantages of phage vectors? Phage vectors can receive longer foreign DNA. Charon 4 can accept up to 20 kb of DNA. Traditional plasmid vectors take much less. Phage vector requires a minimum size of foreign DNA piece of 12 kb inserted. So you can accommodate up to 20 kb. Generally, people use 15 kb, up to 15 kb DNA for cloning into replacement bacteriophage vector. So this is mechanism of cloning of your DNA into the bacteriophage genome when we wish to use bacteriophage as a vector. When we use bacteriophage as a vector, then what we do, we isolate their genome, genomic DNA, then we digest it, and we know through sequencing that what are, where are the restriction sites and what are the non-essential genes. So they digest it. So due to digestion, this is blue part, which is a stopper region, non-essential region, so it is removed. Now, since this is linear, this is not circular, so there are two fragments, remaining fragments, left arm and right arm. This is not circular. So we purify this left arm and right arm this, after this digestion, and mix with our desired DNA fragment so that it will ligate. Now this ligated product, this is now complete genome of that bacteriophage, having our desired DNA which we wish to amplify in the E. coli. We have ligated it. Now we take this, this is a smaller, this is your DNA here showing in a small section or a small figure. So this is your DNA. Then scientists isolate cap protein and the tail protein separately, and they mix together this protein as well as this genomic DNA, and this process is called packaging of bacteriophage head, packaging of recombinant DNA. This is called packaging. When we pack our this recombinant DNA into the head proteins of this bacteriophage, we call it packaging. So after packaging, we infect bacterial culture with this newly packaged virus. We infect it so that it will inject this recombinant genome into the bacteria. And ultimately, you will see bacterial, you will see plaque, viral colonies you will see on plate. This is the mechanism of cloning in bacteriophage vector. So scientists through research, as you know, yes, bolo.
Sir, even the when we had that bacteriophage genome, then we took out the stuffer region and we had the left and the right arm. But it can happen that they can self-ligate.
Yes.
Then how it will we purify?
So good. In case of that is beauty of this. If it will self-ligate, see here. If it will self-ligate, so its size become smaller. Fine?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if its size become smaller, so there is condition I have already discussed that it cannot package. If size is either very small or very big, then it cannot be packaged in this head protein. So it will be screened out. Though this species, self-ligated species are present in this ligation mixture, but it will not survive because this is not packaged in this cap protein. So size is here, screening is size is basis of a screening. This self-ligated part will not be packaged in this cap. So that virus particle will not be infective. It will not infect this host. So it will be screened out. So there is no confusion between self-ligated and this ligated with your desired DNA in this case. Sir. Fine?
Yes, sir.
So, as you know that aviskar, avashyakta hi aviskar ki janni hoti hai. Na? Necessity is the mother of invention. Hai na? So, scientist usko santosh nahi hota hai. Oh, if they are able to clone 20 kb, why not they are able to clone 40 kb? So again, through research, they found not one person, there are several. This is you can say still people are searching and they are trying to create better quality of vectors, other expression vector or other vectors. So they try to clone bigger fragments. For that, they come to know that if only criteria of packaging in the bacteriophage is only cause sites, then why not we remove complete sequence from its genome so that we can package up to 40 and 50 kb of our gene. Are you getting our DNA? So through research, they come to know that only cause sites are responsible for packaging. And they want only that packaging should be done in bacteriophage. After that, we don't need that replication like a bacteriophage particle structure. So cosmid is a hybrid vector having bacteriophage character as well as plasmid character. That's why we called it cosmid. Cos sites plus plasmids. Plasmid components. So cosmid have all the components of plasmid: origin of replication, selection marker, and other things. Except this cos sites, so that it can be packaged into bacteriophage cap protein. But when it will go inside the E. coli, it should replicate like plasmid, so that it can avoid demerits of bacteriophage. And it will get all merits of bacteriophage. So it can carry larger DNA, but it will replicate inside E. coli like a plasmid, like a circular DNA. So cosmid is hybrid. So the recombinant cosmid DNA is injected and circularized like phage DNA, but replicate as a normal plasmid without the expression of any phage function, because there is no phage gene except cos. So, and all the components are plasmids. So when it will go inside, it will duplicate like a plasmid. So behave as plasmid and phage both. So what are the components? It contains cos sites, cohesivins of phage DNA that allow the DNA to be packaged into the lambda phage. So scientists found that this sequence is important to recognize cap protein, and that cap protein will allow packaging of this DNA. If that DNA have that cos sites, 12 bases long cos sites, which is main identity card, you can say. Plasmid origin of replication permitting replication as plasmid in bacteria. Nearly all genome removed, so there is no room for large. So there is room for large inserts. So in cosmid, we can clone up to 40 to 50 kb of DNA. This is high capacity vector. So little fast DNA cannot replicate, but they are infectious, carrying recombinant DNA into bacterial cells. It can infect. So transformation efficiency is less in case of plasmid. So we use their transformation. We can avoid that transformation and we infect that packaged bacteriophage. But when it will go inside, it will replicate like a plasmid. So we have both good characters in this cosmid. You can see this is plasmid, but having this cos sites, this green cos sites. So since cos sites are present in both the terminus in linear genome of bacteriophage, so this is two cos sites. So how we clone? So we digest this plasmid having this cos sites at SMA1 sites. It becomes linear. Then we digest with EcoR1 and then we clone our gene at EcoR1. We cannot clone here because this cos sites should remain free, which is like identity card for packaging into bacteriophage coat protein. Cosmid vector have all the components like a plasmid, except cost sites. Cost sites is cohesive sequence present in bacteriophage genome. So scientists come to know that only cost sites are acting as your identity card for entry of the DNA into the cap protein of bacteriophage head. Fine?
Yes, sir.
So they designed a plasmid. Like MCS, they added this cost sequence. Cost sequence is nucleotide sequence, so they added. So when this is empty, empty means there is no desired gene to be cloned. जिस जीन को क्लोन करना है वो क्लोन नहीं है अभी. सो दिस इज एम्प्टी वेक्टर. सो वी एम्प्लीफाई इट इन ई कोलाई, सो इट विल रेप्लिकेट लाइक अ प्लाज्मिड. देन वी आइसोलेट दैट प्लाज्मिड, देन डाइजेस्ट फर्स्ट विद एस्मा 1. व्हाट विल हैपन, इट बिकम्स लीनियर. देन वी डाइजेस्ट इट विद इको आर 1. सो अगेन देयर इज लेफ्ट आर्म राइट आर्म.
सो फर्स्ट वी डाइजेस्ट विद
एस्मा 1, तो ये लीनियर हो जाएगा, है ना? कॉस साइट शुड बी एट द टर्मिनल.
यस सर.
एंड एज यू नो दिस बैक्टीरियोफाज जीनोम इज लीनियर. दिस सर्कुलर डीएनए कैन नॉट बी पैकेज्ड इनटू बैक्टीरियोफाज, सो इट शुड बी लीनियर. सो वी डाइजेस्ट इट, सो इट बिकम्स लीनियर. देन हियर वी कैन नॉट क्लोन आवर जीन ऑफ इंटरेस्ट और डीएनए ऑफ इंटरेस्ट, नॉट जीन. For cosmic, genes are usually of 1 kb, 2 kb size, 3 kb size. We don't use this vector for cloning of a small gene. We use to clone multiple genes, or you can say longer fragment of DNA, genomic DNA. Generally for this library formation, we use this. So this is not appropriate to call gene cloning. So here we digest it, so it becomes linear. Then we digest at here, so that there are two fragments. There will generate two fragments, left arm and right arm. Then we mix this left and right fragment with our desired DNA fragments. So it will ligate. It will ligate. That
so
ligated.
So I understood till digestion with SMA1.
Yes.
And cost sites, it became linear. So,
yes, it becomes linear. It becomes linear.
Hanji.
Then we digest with eco R1. Then yes, there are this eco R1 to SMA1 one fragment, and there is second fragment which have this all component. Right?
Yes, sir.
Like here, I have already discussed here, na? Left arm, right arm. You can consider.
Yes, sir.
So then we mix our desired DNA. So we mix all three. But our DNA must have both sides, that eco R1 sequence. Then it will ligate here. So now this is linear DNA having cross sites at both terminus. And our DNA, desired DNA fragment, is in between at eco R1. Then we package it into that phage code protein, and then we allow to transfect E. coli. When it will go inside E. coli, since it will circularize there, and since there are all origin of replication and everything is present, it will duplicate like a plasmid. So you can isolate like a plasmid. So this is high capacity vector. So you can see, read some points. Cosmid, first described by Collins and Hans in 1978, is a type of hybrid plasmid with a bacterial origin sequence, origin of replication, and a cos sequence derived from the lambda phage. Cos sequence is from lambda phage. Cosmid DNA containing particles are as transmittable as real lambda phage. So its transmittance, its infectivity is like a normal bacteriophage. But once inside this cell, the cosmid cannot control synthesis of new phage particle, because there is no cap coding gene, no tail coding gene in present. So it will not produce new phage particle, because there is no genomic DNA of phage. So recombinant DNA is therefore obtained from colonies rather than plaques. So in bacteria, in case of bacteriophage replacement vector or insertional vector, it produces plaque. Plaque is a transparent zone in the bacterial lawn, where we consider that due to lysis of the bacteria, there is transparent zone, where from where we can isolate that bacterial colony, bacterial particle, that is part plaque. So in case of cosmid vector, we will not see plaque because there is no bacteriophage particle.
Sir, ये नहीं समझ आया sir.
क्या नहीं समझ आया?
Sir, plaques नहीं समझ आया. Sir, plaques.
Plaques is plaques. PLAQUES plaques. या plaque बोल QUE plaque. Plaque is a like a colonies of virus. आया समझ में?
Yes,
virus,
okay,
due to lysis of the E. coli, virus will break all E. coli. So in E. coli lawn, you will found that a spot where there is no lawn. There is without region of without lawn. That region is called plaque. PLAQUE.
The region without what?
Without bacterial colonies.
Okay, sir.
Because bacterial colonies were lysed by bacteriophage. As you know, in lytic cycle, bacteria is disrupted. Bacteria is brushed. Bacteria se brushed hoke bacteriophage virus nikalta hai. To us jagah par bacterial cell mar gaya, to bacteria ka lawn nahi dikhega. Khali jagah dikhega. That spot is known as plaque.
Okay, sir.
Other persons are getting? Hello?
Yes, sir.
सबको
yes sir
yes sir
good so what are the limitations of this is very good plasma vector but there are limitations slower replication this cannot exist as a high copy because we have added so long DNA that how it can replicate rapidly. It will not replicate rapidly. It's usual things. Anna? Higher frequency of recombination inside bacterial host. So, it will recombine with its own partner. If there are, suppose, two cosmids are present per cell, so it will recombine due to their homologous recombination. So, there is recombination. May form chimera or it will recombine. So suppose you have cloned your DNA fragment, but due to recombination, you will see other. When you isolate that plasmid, that cosmid, so you will find different sequence due to recombination. So there is recombination, possibilities of recombination. So it will confuse your observation. It will confuse your result. And unstable inside E. coli host and thus easy to lose blood. So since it has so long DNA, foreign DNA we are cloning on this cosmid, so obviously after few generation there is chance of losing it because bacteria will not handle that much metabolic load. If we are adding that 40 kb extra DNA in that E. coli, how E. coli will take care of its extra? If you have hundreds of hosts coming, you cannot manage your food. You cannot perform your host duty. So E. coli will not, either E. coli will die or E. coli will degrade or will not allow duplication of that cosmid. It happens. So it will lose. Are you getting? M13 phage. This is not high capacity phage. But this is unique vector we use to produce single-stranded DNA. Whenever we need single-stranded DNA, then we clone our DNA into this vector. Purpose of this vector is to produce single-stranded DNA because this phage have single-stranded genome. This phage, this is also a phage, but it is so you can say linear, long, thin and filamentous. You can see its dimension 900 nanometer long and 9 nanometer in breadth thickness. It's linear filamentous forge having single stranded DNA. So its genome is single stranded, and in this category there are F1 and FT forge. It has also single stranded, and this is also filamentous forge. Filamentous forge only infect enteric bacteria having F5. So this forge will not infect normal bacteria. It will infect enteric bacteria having pilus-like structure, F. pili. Second thing, this bacteriophage cannot lyse the bacteria. Like lambda phage, they lyse the bacteria. They break, they blast the bacteria. They kill the bacteria. But here, this bacteriophage will not lyse the bacteria. M13 vector contains gene fragment with beta galactosidase, multiple cloning sites. So scientists have designed this vector, this its genome for cloning purpose. The advantage of this vector is this first genome is single stranded. Fragment cloned into it will be recovered in the single stranded form. So if you are cloning double stranded DNA, you will get single stranded. Otherwise, I have discussed during sequencing that we have to isolate homogeneous single stranded DNA for sequencing. So scientists were using this phage vector to get single stranded DNA to be sequenced. If you need to sequence some DNA, so you clone it, that DNA, double stranded DNA, into this vector, and this vector will produce single stranded. You can isolate that single stranded DNA and sequence it. For probe, for other things, wherever in molecular biology you need single stranded DNA, you clone your gene or DNA into this vector. Carrying capacity of this vector is very less, only up to 3 kb you can clone. So you cannot get single stranded DNA of size 5 kb. You can only get a small DNA fragment. So for cloning, in its life cycle, there is replicative form where it produces a double stranded. So in that condition, that stage, scientists isolate their genome and clone desired gene, desired DNA fragment, and then again transfect. So what are the applications? For sequencing of DNA fragments using Sanger's methods, we use this vector. For preparation of probe, as you know, probe is also single stranded oligonucleotide in which we attach some radioactively labeled compound or element, or we attach some fluorescent labeled compound or element, so it becomes probe. It will act as a probe. For mutagenesis also, we need single stranded DNA for one type of mutagenesis. There are different methods of mutagenesis. For one type of mutagenesis protocol, we need single stranded DNA where we can add our desired primer and we replicate it so it becomes double stranded. So for mutagenesis, for preparation of probe, for Sanger sequencing methods, we need this vector, M13 vector. Problem of this vector is, limitations of this vector is, the problem is that cloned DNA fragments that are longer than about 3 kb are unstable in M13 vector. Means this vector cannot carry longer than 3 kb of DNA. So if you wish to produce a single stranded DNA of longer size than 3 kb, you cannot use it. This means that M13 cloning can only be used with short piece of. So this is M13 vector. Phosmid. So like cosmid, phosmid is also a hybrid. But here it has characteristic of M13 phage and plasmid. So it is hybrid of plasmid and M13 phage. So that we can, this is a special type of vector we use. So you can see there are two promoters, T3 fast promoter and T7 promoter. So we can produce mRNA against any strand of the DNA. Like when we produce mRNA, so there is one sense strand, one is an antisense strand. So we get antisense strand work as a template for production of mRNA. And we don't get similar sequence to antisense strand of gene. But for this vector, you can get mRNA complementary to both the strands. So if you wish to produce mRNA against one strand, so you can activate this promoter. If you need mRNA against opposite strand, so you activate this promoter. In this way, we can get mRNA against both the strand. In PET vector or PMAL vector, we clone in such a way that upper strand, which is sense strand, we get there, we get similar sequence of that coding strand, that sense strand. We don't get sequence similar to the antisense strand. We cannot produce because promoter is in left side, so we get mRNA which is similar to the upper strand of sequence, that is sense coding strand. Upper strand is coding strand. In this vector, we can get mRNA against both the strands. You can see, like cosmid have aspect of both phage and plasmid. As a MCS, multiple cloning inserted into the lac Z alpha gene to screen blue-white cloning. As origin of replication of single-stranded phage F1, so that it will replicate like a phage F1, that is filamentous phage, single-strand producing phage, permits recovery of single-stranded recombinant DNA. MCS has two phage RNA polymerase promoter, one and each side of MCS. So we can produce single-stranded DNA, we can produce mRNA against both the strand. So this is a special type of vector. I'm quickly coming to YAC vector. And YAC, this is high capacity vector we use for, for human genomic library formation. YAC is artificial chromosome. So as you know, chromosome having, what are the unique feature of chromosome? If you know natural hand, what is the components of hand, then you can produce artificial hand. If you know the structure, anatomy of heart, then you can produce artificial heart. You must have knowledge about chromosome. Then we can produce artificial chromosome. So what are the components present in all chromosome? So you must have seen that all chromosome have telomere. Terminal sequence is known as telomere. All chromosome have telomere. What is the function of telomere? So telomere protects the terminal part of that DNA chromosome, and it also maintains integrity. It will not allow joining with other chromosome. So it maintains integrity. It will not allow cleavage from terminal, and it will also not allow joining with other chromosome. So telomere maintain integrity of chromosome. So all chromosome have these things. So scientists come to know that what are the sequences of telomere. They study different telomeres of different chromosome. So linear DNA have problem of end replication. So extra telomeric sequence helps in that solving the end replication problem. But main function is to maintain integrity. Yes. So telomere. So all chromosome must have telomere. What is the role of centromere? All chromosome have centromere, which helps in division. Centromere function like a handle in a tai chi or briefcase. So that handle can carry complete briefcase. It's so strong. So centromeric region is playing a role in segregation or separation of chromosome. So that is required. Otherwise, bigger DNA will not be separated. Two components are essential for chromosome. So scientists have designed artificial chromosome by adding the natural telomeric sequence, by adding the natural centromeric sequence. So what are the components of YAC? So origin of replication. So you know that eukaryotic origin of replication is known as ARS, autonomously replicating sequence. Without this sequence, chromosome cannot duplicate. So we must have that sequence. Selection marker. So when we transfer it into host, we must know that whether it has been entered into host or not. So selection marker is required. East centromeric sequence is required to ensure proper segregation separation. If there is no centromere, then like a Lambras chromosome and other big giant chromosome, it becomes. The proper segregation is required. So scientists have taken oocyte selection marker and east centromere from east. And then they have taken telomeric sequence from protozoa. And then polylinker sequence from bacterial plasma. In this way, they have taken different fragments and constituted an artificial plasmid. You can see diagram of east artificial vector, east artificial chromosome, you can see. Is artificial chromosome is linear or circular? Is artificial chromosome is linear or circular? Hello. So empty is artificial chromosome is circular. But when we clone DNA fragment, foreign DNA fragment, then it will duplicate like a chromosome. And chromosomes are linear and it will duplicate inside east. That's why we call it east artificial chromosome. But before cloning, it has all the components of plasmid so that we can get multiple copy of this plasmid, empty plasmid, so that we can clone our gene. If it is very less, then isolation become difficult. So there are all components of plasmid present. You can see here. Ampicillin resistance marker, origin of E. coli. Ampicillin resistance marker will work in case of yeast or not? Can we use same selection marker for bacteria as well as yeast? No, why not ampicillin selection marker will work in bacteria? My question is that why we should add extra selection marker?
Don't know, sir.
Huh?
Don't know, sir, actually.
Don't know, chahiye. Will it work in yeast or not? Antibiotic resistance marker will work in yeast or not? My question is this. Just elaborate, Lavanya Singh. Ampicillin, it will not work. Ampicillin will not kill yeast. If it will not kill yeast, then how can you use it as a selection marker? Ampicillin will not kill eukaryote. Kanamycin will not kill eukaryote. These antibiotics will kill bacteria. So if it will not kill, then how can we use their selection misresistance gene as a selection marker? Because even it is not present, this resistance gene is not present in that yeast, it will not going to die by presence of ampicillin. ampicillin cannot kill yeast. So there is no question of ampicillin resistance, whether this vector will go inside yeast or not. Ampicillin will not kill it. So in yeast artificial chromatogram, see quickly, we have this TRP selection marker, TRP1, tryptophan producing genes are here. ARS, as we have seen, that origin of replication of eukaryote, this is centromeric sequence. This is also a selection type of marker. This is URA3, this is also selection marker. This is
BAM. This is centromeric sequence.
Huh?
So centromeric sequence kaun sa hai?
SEN4, this is SEN4. Anna? Yes. SEN4 is centromeric. And this green is telomeric sequence. As you know, there are two telomeres are required, Anna, in both terminals. Centromeric sequence are only one. So only one place there is centromeric sequence. This is DNA sequence. Centromere is DNA sequence, which is added in this vector. So these are components. These components are present in artificial chromatin. Now, when this is empty, in this vector, still we have not cloned our gene, our DNA. This is empty. So empty vector, we add in E. coli so that whenever we need, we can isolate more amount of plasmid. This is acting as a plasmid. So it will replicate, duplicate inside E. coli so that we can get more amount. So we can isolate easily and we can digest it and then ligate with our desired genomic DNA or whatever DNA. So for eukaryote, for yeast, we use auxotrophic selection marker, not antibiotic selection marker, because antibiotic will not kill eukaryote. Agar aisa ho eukaryote, to how can doctor will prescribe us to take penicillin, ampicillin and other antibiotics? They are targeting our bacterial pathogen, not our cell. Ampicillin stops, prevents synthesis of cell wall of bacteria, not eukaryote or other. So if ampicillin will not kill, then there is no question of ampicillin resistance in eukaryote. So we don't use antibiotic resistance marker as a selection marker in eukaryote, in yeast. We use auxotrophic marker, means we use the yeast strain in which that strain is unable to produce tryptophan. So that strain cannot grow in absence of tryptophan. That strain cannot grow in absence of uracil. So how they will grow then? How can we propagate them? So we supply uracil and tryptophan in the media. It cannot synthesize itself. So we provide from, we supplement from outside. But when we transfer this, when we introduce this vector into the yeast, then that yeast become able to produce tryptophan and uracil. That means that yeast will not require extra supplement of uracil or tryptophan. In this way, we select transformed yeast colonies versus non-transformed yeast colonies. Means non-transformed yeast colony will die in absence of tryptophan and uracil. But the colonies, the yeast cell which uptake this vector will survive because this gene supplement and allow production or synthesis of tryptophan and uracil inside yeast. Fine? But for propagation of empty vector, we use E. coli as a host. Yes, that's I am going to discuss, Shreya. So when this is empty, this is circle, that's why I asked you, this is circular, this is plasmid, this is not chromosome now. Before addition of our gene, before cloning of our gene, this is acting as a plasmid. We propagate this plasmid in E. coli. So how can we select in E. coli? For that, we add ampicillin resistance. we add origin of replication of bacteria so that it can replicate inside bacteria. So each artificial chromosome have all the component, almost all components of plasmid, in addition to the all components of chromosome, each artificial chromosome. So this is needed because this is empty. Empty means without cloned our gene. Otherwise, its size become 1000 kb. So this is only, you can consider it 10 kb, less than 10 kb size. So how can we multiply it and get more copy so that we can digest it and check on gel, and then we isolate from gel and then clone our genomic DNA, big genomic DNA. For that, scientists have designed this vector in such a way that we can propagate it in E. coli. So this vector, YAC vector, have all the components of plasmid so that it can duplicate inside E. coli. Are you getting? It will duplicate in the E. coli. So from E. coli, we isolate and then we clone and then we transfer it into yeast. After cloning, this is empty vector. Empty means khali. We have not cloned yet. Fine, Darshan ji.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I got it.
So when we are cloning it, will we remove the ampicillin resistance gene and the one for origin of replication of E. coli?
No. Then it will remain as a silent part, like you are cloning your DNA fragment here. So it will be part of that DNA, that chromosome. It will not hamper. This is DNA sequence. When it will go, I'm going.
Doesn't the yeast cell have some limitation of the size of the plasmid or the vector that is entering?
Okay, you are talking about size. So here, this is high capacity. It can carry up to 1000 kb of DNA. 1000 kb of foreign DNA. In that, if we add 400-500 base pair, means 0.5 kb, then it doesn't matter. We don't have to remove it. Otherwise, it will complicate process. So there is no removal is required. Are you getting?
Yes,
so see, this is diagrammatic presentation of cloning. How we clone our big fragment into this yeast artificial. This is yeast artificial chromosome. For the sake of understanding, this is showing this colored and all these things. So this is double stranded. This is. So we isolate from bacteria and then we digest at two sites. Two sites means one site, restriction site, is here at the terminal of telomere 1 and terminal of telomere 2. So now it becomes this linear. And this part is non-desirable, so we purify and don't use this. Now this become like a chromosome. This is not looks like a chromosome. This is like a plasmid. So we isolate it from E. coli and then we digest it with PAMH1. So this part we remove. Now this is chromosome. As you can see, this is centromere somewhere and this is telomere at terminal. So this is now chromosome. Now where we can clone? So there are some restriction sites. So we digest with EcoR. Again, it becomes left and right arm separate. Then we mix this left and right arm with our desired DNA, which we wish to clone. Generally, genomic fragments. Yes.
Sir, I have one question. Sir, हमारे को एक क्रोमोसोम में तो सेंट्रोमियर चाहिए होता है, because उसको हमने सेपरेट करना है या दोबारा कंबाइन करना है. यहाँ पे तो ऐसा कुछ नहीं है. अगर हमारा डबल स्ट्रैंडेड भी है, इट्स ऑलरेडी जॉइंट, तो हमें सेंट्रोमियर का क्या रोल है इसमें?
सेंट्रोमियर का
सर यहाँ पे क्या जरूरत है सेंट्रोमियर की?
See, this is now chromosome having that recombinant chromosome, you can say. So when it will go inside, how it will segregate? जब ये डुप्लीकेट होगा क्रोमोजोम, तो ये फिर सिग्रीगेट कैसे होगा? सिग्रीगेशन में सेपरेशन.
तो सर अब ये रेप्लिकेट एज अ क्रोमोसोम करेगा वहां जाके?
यस, नाउ वी आर ट्रांसफरिंग इनटू ईस्ट. ओके, आफ्टर क्लोनिंग विद दिस वी ट्रांसफर इनटू ईस्ट. आई हैव आइसोलेटेड दिस प्लाज्मिड फ्रॉम ई कोलाई so that we can get more copy. Chromosome cannot exist in a thousand copy. समझ रहे हो?
Yes sir.
So if it plasmid, if it is in few copy, then it's not, we cannot handle. It's very less. So we try to make it as a plasmid so that we can isolate in more copy. We can digest. So digestion में loss होगा बहुत सारा purification में loss होगा. So we must have high amount of that plasmid. But this plasmid have all the components of chromosome, all the sequences of chromosome. So this is looks like it chromosome. Now somewhere here there are restriction in enzyme sites. So we cut it. There is here we have seen there is eco-R1 sites. So we digest it with eco-R1. So it will fragment into two parts. Anywhere in this DNA, this is DNA, hana? Anywhere this DNA, there should not be eco-R1 sites. There is only single site, so it produced two fragments. Now we mix two fragments with our genomic DNA fragments. Suppose we wish to prepare human genomic library. So what we will do, we fragment our genome isolated from blood or tissue or somewhere, and then we fragment it and we mix it. So that now, after this ligation, this chromosome becomes this. This is your target DNA, yellow part. Now we transfer this, we transform yeast cell, yeast competent cell you can say, but in case of yeast we don't say competent, we use that spheroplast method and electroporation method. So now we introduce it into this cell. Now don't ask, this size is very big and this size, this is diagram, so that you can understand. This cell is very bigger than this DNA. Don't ask, sir, why this DNA, how this DNA will go inside this small cell. This is diagram. This cell have very big size than this DNA. Fine? This is also same thing. Samjhane ke liye, this is chromosomal DNA. Suppose this is your chromosomal DNA. You have digested it with eco-R1, so you will get different fragments. This is your YAC vector. You have digested it with GAMH1. So you will get that linear having telomere at two sides. This is one part, this is second part. Then we mix this with this. So you will get this. Are you getting? This is chromosome. Sir. We transfer this chromosome into yeast, and then we select that transformed yeast and then we propagate. In this way we prepare for introducing gene into yeast. There are different other methods are also, like yeast integrative plasmids. So if you wish to integrate your gene into existing chromosome of the yeast, so that it should express or it should replicate based on their chromosome, not independently, then we design this vector, yeast integrative plasmid. So that once it will go inside the yeast, your gene will be integrated into the chromosome, existing chromosome of yeast. Yeast epigenomal plasmid, so it will exist independently. As I have already told you that this is exceptional plasmid which is present in the eukaryote yeast. So this vector is based on 2 micron plasmid. So you can also express your gene epigenomally without. So in case of yeast artificial chromosome, we ligate more than 1000 kb gene. Up to 1000 kb gene we ligate it. But sometimes we need to express our gene which are 1 kb, 2 kb size. So in that case you can use this plasmid vector, 2 micron plasmid vector. EUC, PBR or PET will not survive in yeast. So we have to use this yeast plasmid. We express epigenomally also yeast centromeric plasmid. So it is centromere, but there is no telomere. So it will exist as a plasmid. But since there is centromere, so even larger plasmid can segregate. Function of centromere is to separate duplicated DNA, duplicated plasmid. So centromeric region will help in efficient separation and segregation of duplicated plasmid. So people are using this type of plasmid also, or vector, you can say vector, and this is artificial, I have already discussed that. This is exactly chromosome. Others are plasmid types, circular, and all these have less capacity. अब हम हाथी को रखे हैं सिर्फ छोटा काम करने के लिए तो नहीं होगा, सो छोटा काम करने के लिए हम ये सब वेक्टर का यूज करते हैं. We use this artificial chromosome to integrate longer DNA, to clone longer DNA. Generally for genomic library preparation and other purpose. So there are some limitations in this artificial chromosome. There is formation of chimera. You can see chimera formation is frequent in case of yak. Chimera means so recombination takes place, so that if you are cloning your 1000 kb gene in one vector, so it will form it will recombine and form chimeric DNA, so it will confuse your observation. You will not find out that what you have cloned and what you are getting. So chimera formation is the main drawback of this artificial chromosome. It forms a chimera, it recombines. For that, scientists again try to find out the alternate of that yak. So they find that F vector based plasmid, F plasmid exists in few copy per cell, and which is larger plasmid. So they try to explore how it is replicating and segregating efficiently. Though they are circular, they segregate efficiently. So they prepared that bacterial artificial chromosome which are based on F plasmid, and the replication of F factor is strictly controlled in E. coli, so that it cannot go beyond two copy per cell. So it exists as 1 to 2 copy per cell. And it can stably maintain DNA of size up to 300 kb to 500 kb kilo base pairs. F factor carrying inserted bacterial DNA capable of maintaining fragments as large as 1 mega. So what are the components in this bacterial artificial chromosome? Let me check if there is. So from here you can see, in bacterial artificial chromosome, there is PAR gene, partitioning gene. So there are partitioning gene which help in efficient segregation of that bacterial artificial chromosome. It can carry longer DNA equivalent to yak. But this vector cannot exist as a chromosome, but we call it chromosome. This is circular. This is always circular. Generally, chromosomes are linear, but this is circular, still we call it chromosome, bacterial artificial chromosome, because it can carry longer DNA. That's why we call it bacterial artificial chromosome. But this is not exactly chromosome. There is no telomeric sequence, there is no centromeric sequence. Since its capacity is more, carry capacity is more, so, and this is invented, or you can say used after this artificial chromosome. So people call, scientists call it chromosome, but there is no characteristic feature of chromosome, which is circular. But it has that equivalent to centromeric region, which contains chromosome, PAR gene, partitioning, which helps segregation of circular DNA. So in this bacterial artificial chromosome, there are PAR A, PAR B gene which help in segregation, and other components are like a normal plasmid, and it has longer carrying capacity. These are some examples. These are all trade name. Company which designed this and supply this, this is all name. So now we can compare bacterial artificial chromosome and this artificial chromosome. So bacterial artificial chromosome can hold up to 300 or sometimes 500 also, 500 kilo base pairs of DNA, foreign DNA. Yak can hold up to 500 to 1000 kb of DNA. This back is F factor of E. coli is capable of handling large segments of DNA. So this is F factor based, F plasmid based. Its backbone is F plasmid. YAC are designed to replicate as plasmid in bacteria when no foreign DNA is present. No foreign DNA is present means empty plasmid, empty vector. So it can replicate like a plasmid. I have already told you that we replicate inside bacteria. After that, we isolate it and insert our bigger DNA, and then we introduce into yeast. So once the fragment is inserted, YAC are transferred. They then replicate as eukaryotic chromosome. Recombinant bacs are introduced into E. coli by electroporation. Electroporation, we will discuss. This is a method of transforming your DNA into the host cell by applying electric field. The examples of bac are PBAC108L. YAC contains a yeast centromere, two yeast telomere, bacterial origin of replication and bacterial selection marker, and yeast selection marker also. BAC has a set of regulatory genes, ORES, REP-E, which controls F factor replication, and PAR-A, PAR-B, which limits the number of copies to 1 to 2. So this origin of replication helps in controlling the number of copies, and PAR controls its segregation, separation. It has chloramphenicol resistant gene and other, maybe ampicillin also. Here, YAC plasmids to yeast chromosome. DNA inserted into a unique restriction sites and cleaves the plasmid with another restriction endonuclease that removes a fragment of DNA and causes the YAC to become linear. So I have already shown you in figure how to clone our desired DNA fragment into yeast artificial chromosome. So this is overall about BAC and YAC. We use for genome mapping, determining chromosomal aberration, creation of infectious clones, all these, they are different functions for BAC and YAC. So overall, I have discussed about pillars of recombinant DNA technology in which we discussed enzyme and vectors. I have not
sir, previous slide, sir, applications likha tha na, jispe, yes, sir.
Haan, yes.
Sir, ek minute ye read kar le.
Karo. जीनोम मैपिंग, जीनोम का मैप करने के लिए डिटरमाइनिंग क्रोमोसोमल एबरेशंस, ऑल दिस थिंग्स, सिंस इट कैरी लॉन्गर डीएनए, सो जीनोम असेंबली में उसका हम यूज करते हैं, लाइब्रेरी बना के फिर उसके बाद.
सर क्रोमोसोमल एबरेशन क्या होगा?
क्रोमोसोमल एबरेशन नहीं सुना? कुछ क्रोमोसोम का एक फ्रैगमेंट टूट गया है, नलीजोमी हो गया, trisomy ho gaya, tetrasomy. You have not heard that some of the human have 47 chromosome also.
Yes, sir.
Klinefelter syndrome, Down syndrome, and yes, all these are due to chromosomal aberrations. Hana?
Okay. Yes.
So
sir,
using that we can find out chromosomal aberration since it has longer DNA, so we can easily find out. Fine?
Yes, sir.